Check, check. All right. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Super Mentor 28. This special event is brought to you by Foreign Policy Community of Indonesia and the Embassy of Poland in Jakarta. My name is Afni and I will be your master of ceremony. Ladies and gentlemen, we will have an exciting, if not inspiring, discussion on push your limits to confront the global challenges, lesson learned from the pole expedition. And we have here with us a special guest, Marek Kaminski, North and South Pole conqueror, founder of Lifeplan Academy and Kaminski Academy, to share his stories and knowledge. Welcome, Mr. Marek. Thank you. Before we start the event, please enjoy the following videos of FPCI activities. Please give a big round of applause. While we dive into our discussion, please don't forget to share your moment with us by tagging at FPC Indo and at PLD Indonesia on your social media posts. Now, to kick off our event, I would like to invite Cesare Felipe, Deputy Head of Office, Police Investment and Trade Agency Jakarta, for his opening remarks.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Selamat sore. Yeah? So my name is Cezary Filipek. I'm, as mentioned, the deputy head of Polish Investment and Trade Agency, which is worth mentioning. It's a government agency responsible for all the trade and investment related aspects. And we are not part of the embassy. We are like parallel to embassy, but of course working very closely with all the matters. So that's just a few words of me. I've been in Indonesia for over 10 years altogether. And today we have a very special day. Yeah? It's also a special day for me as well, because this day is about education, but it's about something more. Yeah, it's about your dreams, about desire, and about something even more than that. It's about the failure, resistance, not giving up, to get to the where we are. I came to Indonesia first time 2004. There were very different times to come for traveling. It was very exotic fair land. And these are the times I was looking at Mr. Marek exploration of the North and South Pole. Very inspiring days, moments, how one man, which you will hear in a moment, can reach to places like this so far and so difficult. And after 20 years of being connected to Indonesia, we just met recently in Warsaw, just 1 month ago, and we spoke at the Polish Forum of Business about the opportunity of joining Tunisia, because what we are doing now, it's we have a Poland Festival, which is the largest, this is also interesting, it's the largest program promoting Poland in whole Asia. We were expecting about 500,000 visitors. Last year we have 200,000. So if you have a chance and time, please visit Grand Lucky Peak Avenue on Saturday or Grand Lucky Eszebede, Grand Lucky Eszebede on Sunday, Grand Lucky Peak on Saturday. And there's something very interesting. We are running car-free day, Copernicus Walk. Nicolaou Copernicus, as you may know, was an astronomer, philosopher, very, very important person who discovered how this whole solar system works. And because of 550 years anniversary of his birth, we make this walk. So you're all invited. On Sunday morning, 6 a.m., we start Bundaran Hai. We walk to Grand Lucky. Everybody who comes will get a free t-shirt, drinks, Polish food, snacks, and a lot of other attractions. Yeah. So without stretching this, I'd like to invite Mr. Marek as well here. And very, very happy that I will have opportunity with you as well to share experience of this gentleman. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cezary. You may go back to your seat. And before we begin our main session, I would like to inform everybody that we have prepared 5 exclusive books by the Poland Embassy for those of you who asked the first 5 questions to Mr. Marek. So don't miss it up. And before also we welcome Mr. Marek to the stage, please enjoy this video of his trip to the North and South Pole.
Yeah, sure.
Right, what a wonderful journey. Yes. Now, without further ado, let's have a relaxing and heart-to-heart conversation with Mr. Marek. Mr. Marek, you may now have the floor.
Hi, nice to meet you. How is it in Indonesia? Good afternoon. I don't know. I think will be the presentation behind me, so I try to follow. I don't have the pilot, but I think it will be okay. So I don't know. Do you like to travel?
Yes.
Yes? Oh, traveling is good, actually. Yes. And I like to travel too, and it was very interesting for me, the process, how the dreams become reality. Normally, sometimes the people have the dreams, sometimes no, but sometimes it's very hard to follow the dreams. So maybe we can set like 1 minute per slide, so I have not to say next. So we can make like 1 minute per slide. So in my life, I started with the books. Actually, yes, when I was maybe 5 years old, I broke my arm and I spent half a year in hospital without parents. So instead of relying on other people, I have to rely on me. And from this time, I started to be friend of myself, and I started to get the power for myself, the power to make the dreams reality. And with the expeditions or with the dreams, following the dreams is like the iceberg. One seventh of the iceberg is below above the sea level. And seven parties down, and but what you see, like the expedition itself, is a short time, but the preparation and everything, you need a lot of time to prepare yourself for the expedition. So in my case, when I was 14 years old, I made my first journey alone without parents to Denmark. And then when I was 15 years old, I went to the journey to Africa, also without parents, to Marrakesh. I spent some time in Sahara Desert. And then when I was 16 years old, I hitchhiked through, I'm from Poland, so I live in Europe. So I hitchhiked through across all Europe. When I was 17 years old, I traveled across big part of Asia, across Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Russia, and many countries in Asia. And then I studied philosophy and physics. So from education, I am philosopher and physics. And studying the physics, I learned that the borders, the limits of my language, are the limits of my world. So somehow, the story that you told yourself, about the world, become reality sooner or later. So for some people, the dreams has a meaning, for others has no meaning. For some people, love has a meaning, and for some others has no meaning. So, and then because of the meaning you give to the words or the language you speak, because the language is not only the words, but it's also the meaning. So they become decisions, and decisions became a job, became a work, became a partner's relationship, house, and everything. So somehow, sooner or later, this is what I believe in. The limits of my language are the limits of my existence. So in my case, when I was 20 years old, I went to expedition to the Mayas cities in Yucatan, in Mexico. I met two jaguars face to face, and then I became the first Pole to cross Greenland. The Greenland is a big island with the ice cap, so I crossed 600 kilometers the ice cap. And then with my friend Wojtek Moskal, we went to the North Pole. I'm not sure if you know where is the North Pole. It's just the end of the planet, yes, in Arctic. And actually, our planet has two ends. One is the North Pole, and the second is the South Pole. And between the North Pole and South Pole, we have all our planet. So this is actually the slide from the North Pole trip. So first, I went with my friend Wojtek Moskal to the North Pole, and we walked by ski on the frozen Arctic Ocean. So we started from the North Canada and crossed 770 kilometers. The North Pole is under sea in the Arctic Ocean. So you walk on the ice that is sometimes very thin, and the bottom is 4 kilometers down. So you can die. This kind of expedition is quite dangerous. You can die in many ways. You can die from the cold because the temperature is like minus 60 degrees. So you can freeze, or you can have frostbitten, or you can meet polar bear, and you can be eaten by polar bear. When you met the polar bear on this latitude, so is the sometimes the question, who will eat him for the dinner? So you can also. Oh, this is the human being before the reaching I think it was the North Pole. So you can also die, be drawn in the water. Because the ice can break and you can fall down in all the equipment, and it's very hard to swim in the minus 60 degrees, even if you're a good swimmer. You can also die from exhaustion, from different illness that are connected with your body. But the mental resilience is also very important. I think the mental power in this kind of trips is more important than the physical power. This is the head, not the legs and body, reach the North Pole or the South Pole. So, in order to prepare for such a trip, we have a special training. A little bit like a cosmonaut, or a little bit, it is preparing for this kind of trip is like to go in the space. So we even use some technology from the space trip, or we use our food supply was like the same like used in the space. So we have to drag. To pull in the sledge 150 kilograms of fuel to melt the water from the snow, food and tent and sleeping bags and everything that is needed. So in order to prepare for such trip, we were pulling the tires, the car tires behind. So when I met the people, I said that my car is not far away, because it is strange view that the normal human being is pulling the tires behind. Normally they are on the car. So, but it was the only way to prepare the body and mind for pulling the sledge with 150 kilograms across the Arctic Ocean. So as I said, we started from the north of Canada. And as you see, this is like the ocean, and to walk under frozen water, the water sometimes break. You have open lids, like up to 2 kilometers. So actually, it's very easy to give up and to say, "Oh, it's dangerous. I won't go to mama or to papa, and I want to go home." And but so you really need mental resilience and mental power to survive in such hard conditions, to be motivated, to keep going. And the same year, I became the first person in history who went to poles in 1 year. The same year, I went to the north, to the South Pole. The South Pole trip was 1,400 kilometers, and it took 2 months, and the average height of 3,000 meters, with the temperatures like in the Antarctic is the lowest temperature in this planet, -89.9 degrees Celsius. So it's very cold. The difference, for example, between so for the first month the temperature was like -60 degrees. So when the temperature arise to -30, I had the feeling that I am in tropical country and I can just go in the swimwear. So the difference between -30, -60 is the same like between 0 and 30. So I think some of you experience 0 degrees and 30. 30 is around 30 is now. So it's the same between -30 and -60. So the hell of the cold has many layers, like every hell. So this was the other trip that was a couple of years later. I went with disabled boy, Jasiek Mela. So you have the video on the beginning that was from this trip. So the Jasiek Mela, when he was 13 years old, he lost arm and leg. He was hit by the electricity and his arm and leg was amputated. And with my friends, we started to think how to help him. And we decided to help him by sharing the experience, how to reach the dreams, we wanted to learn him how to catch the fishes, not to give them the fish. This is the difference. So in order to share experience, we decided to go to the expedition to the North Pole and South Pole, and we did it, and he was the first disabled person who reached the South Pole and North Pole in the same year, and he was 15 years old when when he did it. And of course it was many preparation with the doctors, and we have to develop special prosthesis from titanium for him to survive in -60 degrees Celsius. And the training was really hard, and he was exceptional. Now he's motivational speaker, and he inspired the people around the world and help also the people with amputation, because this is still a big mental problems if you are ill, or especially if you arm and leg is amputated, you think that your life is over, but it's not true. You still have a lot of possibilities, and you still can reach your Everest and or your poles. And and the Jasiek Mela was a good example of this. And so I did like maybe 80 extreme expeditions. It will be hard to tell about all of them. One of the last one was no trace expedition with the electric car. I was the first person who drive with 100% electric car from Poland to Japan and back through all Asia. Actually, I was the first person who crossed all the Asia alone in the electric car with Nissan Leaf. No trace, like no leaving the trace in the nature. So it was about sustainability. But also about empowering the people, because I think the sustainability is not only about the rubbish or about the pollutions, it's about the balance. And in order to have balance outside, you have to have balance inside. So I think that the most of the things that are connected with solution is that like our internal imbalance. So I think that was the very important part of this expedition. So I crossed 30,000 kilometers with 9 countries like Russia, Gobi Desert, Mongolia, China, South Korea, to Japan and back. And from this time, I started to work on this internal balance and on the mental power. So I started to work with technology. And in the COVID time, we realized that the mental issue is a big problem. It's a big problem among young people. And the number of mental illness or mental problems is increasing. I think the depression is become like pandemic worldwide, and due to the World Health Organization, it will be, I'm not sure, like 30 million people in the world with depression soon. And especially among young people in Poland, Europe, but I think the same in Indonesia, the number of depression or the number of suicide attempt is increasing, and the meaning of life, having the goals, balance, mental health is become more and more problematic. It's even hard to think about going to the North Pole, South Pole. For some people, it's hard to think to go to the job or to go to the school. So in order to deal with this problem, we started to work on the solutions. First on the workshops, and because big part of my expedition was the mental resilience, because I have unpredictable world outside me, the constant danger of life, the constant changing world. So I have to adapt, and the mental resilience is about the art of adaptation to the fast changing world. And because nowadays the world is changing so fast, so for many people it's hard to copy with this. They are lost. Yes, they have no solution. They don't know what is going on. So you have some numbers in Poland, but I think that Indonesia, probably the numbers will be percentage will be more or less the same about the burn for the companies, like about burnout problem about mental issues, about depression, or about lack of meaning of the life. So with the psychiatrists and the psychologists, the team, we started to work on the workshops and the programs, how to build mental resilience, because mental resilience is also the future skills. Maybe you heard about the future skills. So mental resilience is number one, is very important for the education also, because resilience is also about motivation for motivation, which is also important for education, and motivation to have grades or motivation to get a good job or to get in the good university, but also motivation for overcoming the failures, because the life is not about reaching the goals only and about successes, but first of all, to have a success, you have to deal with the failures, because to have a success is about resolving the problems. And normally, if you have ambitious goals, there is many problems on the way. So Winston Churchill said that success is going from failure to failure. Winston Churchill was a prime minister of Great Britain during the Second World War, a very famous person, and he deal with the Hitler and he deal with German Nazis, etc. And somehow he was participating in winning with the Nazism. I think it's quite nice sentence. There's a success is going from failure to failure without losing enthusiasm. But the question is how to do it. And especially if you have many failures, yes? And uh, And there is many problems and many issues in this. So during my expedition, I got a lot of experience how to reach the goals, because expedition is also about reaching goals. You have the goal, like North Pole, Everest, South Pole, crossing desert, going to Japan, and you have to prepare for the journey and then make it, or make it not, or and deal with the consequences, and have experience. Maybe have experience for the next trip or for the next project. So, in order to prepare Jasiek to this trip, I formulated the pole method, the pole because the North Pole is a good metaphor of reaching the goals, because if you reach the North Pole, you cannot stay there like in life. If you reach the goal, you cannot be in the same time for the rest of your life. The life go on and you have to have next goals. So this is why this is the circle, this method. And the first step is about discovery of pole, is about defining the goals. Is also very important how to define your goals, short and long term goals. It's not easy, it's not obvious. And then the planning the road to the goal. And then the goal, the road is important, not the goal. It's mean you need motivation, you meet redefining the goals, redefining the plan, adapt. And then dealing with failures and dealing with successes, because I think that the success and failure is only the step, and you have to go further. So what is important is potential of success and the failure. If you can use the potential of failure, you can turn it to the success in the future. And if you cannot use the potential of success, you can turn it to the big failure. So and then the last step, get to know yourself. I think it's not easy, it's not obvious, because all the education is about outside world, and normally the people they know better outside world than themselves, and normally the people or students they are teach how to discover the outside world. How to discover, how to have a success in the outside world, by they don't know nothing about themselves. You have the illusion that you know yourself, but many of people, if they are alone in silence, they have fear. They have fear to be alone. They have to fear to be alone with yourself, because the people nowadays they are not friend of yourself. And I think it is very hard to get connected to yourself. Normally, due to education, we are disconnected. And the more we are disconnected, the more we can have successes in the outside world, but we are far away from ourselves. So this method seems very obvious, but it's not. And it's a lot of details, and it's a lot of exercise. And normally, the full program for this method is 150 hours. But to give you just an example, if you think about this sentence, know yourself, this sentence was formulated in the, like, maybe 3,000 years ago by Socrates or Platon. And I think maybe 10,000 books was written on this topic, know yourself. So however, it is very easy sentence, and only two words, know yourself. It's a big issue, I can assure you. So I think that there is a very famous writer, Harari, but many people wrote it recently, that we are living in the time where the algorithms of Google, Facebook, Instagram, that they know you better than yourself. So you can like lose it, you are losing like a free will, and you have no really power to navigate it your life, because you are navigated by algorithm of the governments, corporation, etc. Using the technology, without your knowledge, you are navigated by technology. However, you have this illusion that you navigate technology. So this is why this knowing yourself is so important nowadays. So yes, we created an application, LifePlan app. You have this functionality of this application here above. We have, for example, the trust chat that the young people with the problems can chat and ask the question, and so it's like instant psychological help. We have also the session with trainers, and we have the program. You can download the application is free; it's also in English. You can download it from the Apple Store or from the Google Play. So it is funny that you are using technology to overcome problem of technology, but I think this is like with the South Pole and North Pole. North Pole and South Pole, they are two edges of our planet, and they seem to be opposite, yes? But the whole Earth is between these two poles. So the same, the human soul and our mind, our soul and technology, they are two edges of the humanity, and we are the connections. So it's still us. And it is like with a knife. You can use the knife to make a home or to make a food, to cut the bread, and you can also use the knife to hurt some or even kill someone. So it is not technology. It is not technology, but the how you use technology is important. So we try to use technology for a good purpose. So we built also a diagnostic for mental resilience. The diagnostic is based on the web tools, and it's quite good report after this. So we have different kind of diagnostic, like for young people, for business. We have also solution for the big companies. We work with companies like Nestle, Facebook, or banks, consulting company like Price Waterhouse, and many big corporations from Poland and abroad. And it is interesting for me as the philosopher and physicist to create this solution. And the next test we will do, it will be like diagnostic of the human potential, of human skills, of the future skills. So we will combine this different tests to have a full spectrum of human potential, and then it can be used for planning the job, for planning the future, maybe even for marriage, I don't know. This is quite interesting that the resilience, mental resilience, can be like a basis for different things in the life. But as I said in the beginning, that for us the mental resilience is the basis of everything, because without mental resilience, if you break, if you have depression, if you have bipolar disease, if you have no meaning of life, there's nothing from your education, nothing for your job. You can just die or to commit suicide. So at the end, I will tell you that if you think about life like going up to some mountain and have a success to be on the top, I can assure you that on the top of the mountain, the top of the mountain is not reached by the people who have the best grades in the school, who are very smart and very very tough physically. They are all the people who are very beautiful. It helps, of course. It's not bad to be to have a good good grades and to be pretty or beautiful or to be smart or to be tough, but at the end on the top is reached by the people who are resilient for the bad weather, for the avalanche, for a step walls they are on the way, and normally on the way to the success they are the storms and walls breaks or place with problems. So in order to overcome it, you have to be resilient. So that's more of course we have many solutions for companies, we work with the local governments in Poland, we work with the school, we work with universities, but this is details. If you have any question, I can, you can ask the question about everything what I said about life, and we can discuss. Maybe this is better than to have a monologue only. Yes. Thank you very much.
So I am the president of the student council in my school, and I feel like being a leader of a lot of people also held a really big responsibility, and also it needs a lot of bravery to make a decision and to be the head of who makes a decision. And it's been a really wonderful time since I've become the president in my student council, but at times I feel like I still feel uncertain when I have to make a decision, and I still feel like I'm afraid that some of the people won't accept that decision, and I'm just afraid of what other people would think of the decision that I will make, even though I've already thought of my decision is the best decision for the student council and for our members together. But I just feel at times I feel unconfident with my own decisions, because I think it's because of the fact that I think too much of what other people say and what other people will think of it. Since being a leader also it needs being a good leader also has to be resilient. What advices do you have for young leaders like me that needs to lead a group of young of youth people as well, so that they can be more more sure of their decisions, and so that they're not afraid to make any decision and they can be more confident in themselves? Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. I think it's a good point. In the expedition, like small expedition, we were the partners, so we made decision like together. And I learned from the expedition that if you make a decision for a group of the people, if you are the team leader, it's good to discuss it. Yes, to be open with the problems. But on the end, you have to take a decision. So I think that you have first to be leader for yourself. So you have to trust yourself to be leader for the other people. Because if you don't trust yourself, if you are uncertain, it's a little bit harder to be leader for the other people. So I would say that first you have to trust yourself, and the leadership, no, it's not about be perfect. It's not about make perfect decision. You sometimes you can make a bad decision, but what is important is responsibility. So you can deal with consequences. Even if you have to trust yourself, if you take bad decision, you can still deal with consequences. So I think the process of making decision is the process of dealing also with consequences of the good decision and also the bad, and to be responsible for. So like if you make mistakes, it's very important to be open, right? To not to say that it's not my mistake, it's because of the bad weather, but sometimes yes, the people make, I think maybe it's hard to say bad decision. Maybe by the decision you can meet other things that you expected, yes, or something changed, or so. I think that for me, for example, visualization takes within making the good decision. The very important is I use it also in this poll method, visualization. And what is visualization? It's like because normally you think that everything will be fine, yes, but it is nice to think about the problems that you can meet. So it is like visualization is like to watch the movie about the future, yes, in this case. So it is very hard to have this movie because you have not enough data. So in order to make a good decision, you have to collect data. And it is normally the people make like superficial decisions because they have nothing, you know, we have not enough data. We have no enough time. We are in the rush. We are under pressure. So even though it is nice to collect data for a good decision. So it was, I think, later. I think it's a previous number of Harvard Business Review, and the one of the last issue is making decision in the time of chaos. So I recommend you to read it. It's also good stuff. So at the end, we are living in turbulent time. So it is nice to by making the decision to. It is nice to making also the bad scenario, not only the good scenario. And trust yourself. This is my advice.
This book is actually about Polish language, but also about Poland culture, and it's translated by one of our Polish expats living in Yogyakarta. Yeah, so he's a writer, also philosopher, traveler, and this is one of the book that he tried to talk about Poland from Indonesian perspective. So anybody who asked a question, and any question is good, there's no bad questions. Questions, every question is good. The books are here, yeah?
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Marek. I love to watch movie action. Like
yes.
Last time is Mission Impossible, but I believe hearing directly from the real adventure is more interesting. That's why. Number one, during your experience, what is the most scariest moment? Like almost, I'm gonna lose my life this time. That's all. During your last number one, number two, and the last number two, really. The mental health in Indonesia is also crazy. Last 3 weeks, there was a student girl, a college. So she invited her parents, come, I will graduate, she said. But then at night, out of nowhere, her parents already come, but then she climb up to the hill and then jump. She lied. She just afraid to admit that I'm still not graduated. Right in front of that school, and some stories about suicide in college or I have this my junior. Really, it's really a real matter, the mental health problem. And I was also a parent of two kids still, and I was quite worried about this, you know, the challenge. If you can analyze what's the problem, like. Hey, they live in the socialized, like they want, they have to do good. And what's your, about this very, very pressure for the,
yes.
Say, yeah, that's all, thank you.
Yes, about the scariest moment, I think the, I think that normally this fear is in ourselves, yes? The fear is first is in ourselves, but the fear itself is a good emotion. It is like information. All the emotions are information. So this is, but as with the all information, you have to know how to read them, like decode them. And normally the people are managed by fear, and but it's possible to, like that we are managing the fear, but we are not managed by fear. So in my life, I because I did maybe 80-100 expeditions, so I started to realize how to somehow not escape from the emotions, but how to read the emotion and how to use them, because you can say that emotion is the energy, yeah, it's kind of energy. So the fear can bring you down, like you are. I don't make a next step. I have a fear. I don't think about it to make it because it's not for me. But you can also, the fear is neutral, but you can also use the fear as the energy that put you forwards. Of course, it's not easy to explain it, how to use this energy. But as I said, everything somehow is energy. So also the fear. And you can use this energy if you can, like, I would say, how to say, reframe it, yes? Reframe fear, so you can use this energy to grow up. And in my life, the scariest moment was this, like, meeting two jaguars, like, face to face, and you can do not anything. I didn't have a gun, nothing. I just have only my mind and intuition, and I survive. But it was also like falling in the water in the Arctic Ocean and by minus 30 degrees. And I have no, even I finally get out of the water, I have no clothes to change because I have only one set. So I have to dry this under my body. I was in kind of avalanche also. So it was many scariest moment in my life, but I learned how to manage it. So so I survive. I'm still alive. And it, yes, the niche, I think I thought that I have no trauma, but it was a famous German philosopher, Friedrich Nietzsche. And he said that the one who looks in the eye of devil has to remember that devil looks in his eyes. So it's like about if you meet bad things, you need to remember that they are still inside you. But I think I don't have a trauma. I overcome it. One of the methods that I use to overcome the trauma, because a lot of things I do with, because as I said, I try to be friend of myself from the beginning of my life. So yes, I am friend of myself. Even I lose all the friends, I have still have one friend. I'm following my intuition. And when I went to the North Pole and South Pole, I keep the journal. You know, like I wrote like every morning and every evening I wrote for 10 minutes. It was by intuition, and I feel very good by this. And then there is a method of therapy that is called journaling. So in fact, I put all my emotions in the diary, yes, in the journal, and I reset my mind. So sometimes, somehow, I purify my mind during the way. So my mind is clean. Mind is brain. brain, mind, or soul. My soul is, yeah. So my, this is kind of mindset that it's like with you now. It is like with the physical effort. If you do a lot of training, you need the for the athletes, the quality of the training is as important as a quality of reset or relax. So if you do very tough training, you need also like massage maybe or sauna or whatever to relax, yeah, or good sleep. So the same is for your mind. If you have the tools, so if you just let your body without relax, you have this trauma in the body. And the same is with the mind. If you have tools, how to reset your mind from the trauma, but not, you know, if the trauma is big, is I give you other example. You know, the house has a basement, yes? So like the trauma is the things that you have in basement. If you compare the mind to the house, so this is some conscious mind. Where can be the trauma? The trauma can be also in the body. So you can clean the basement every week, and then you have everything is nice in the basement, or you just leave it, and then you know it will be bad things there. To dealing with trauma is dealing with this every day by kind of techniques that allows you to reset and not leave it alone. And the second question was about suicide, about just mental problems for the young people. So I think this is the complex of the things. There's many like vectors that create this situation. One of the vectors is of spin of this is fast changing world, technology, and then it's a lifestyle, the family. I'm sure that the people in Indonesia, they are busy with work, and the parents has no time for child. Yes. The relationship between children and parents are like separate, and people are atomized, yes, like alone, living alone. And so the diagnosis of this situation is, it can be complicated, but anyway, I think what is important is how to deal with this. Even if you don't know the reasons, because the one thing, this is like with the diseases that of course you can ask yourself why you have this kind of infection, but you can also use the like antibiotic or some kind of medicine to heal it, even if you know, if you don't know how you get this infection, from whom. So the same with for sure that there is the this number of this mental issue is increasing, and we can leave the reasons to analyze this for sociology people or, you know, for people who can do the analysis. But what is important is to deal with consequences. So to find solutions. Because the problem is that the people, the young people, they are, yes, the first problem, they are not attached to themselves. Yes, so the failure is like losing everything. The model that we are learned that we have to have only successes in life is a bad example. Yeah, you have. The first, you have learned to deal with failures, not only to have a success. And I think that we are learned that you should be the first, you should be the best, you should have a success, etc., etc. But life is not about successes. Life is about dealing with problems, and sometimes you have success. So this is I think one of the reasons that there is the bad model of education. And now the other thing, I think that in Indonesian school there is like in the schools they are physical training, right? Like 2 hours in week or something, or 1 hour, I don't know how many hours. One or two. But do you have psychological training?
No.
So this is the problem, that we have physical training, but we don't have and mental training nowadays is more important than the physical. But it's like this topic is not existing in the education system, and this is one of the reasons. I think if I would say the one reason for this situation is a lack of psychological training, at least 1 or 2 hours per week, and it will be enough to decrease the number of the mental issue by, I don't know, 30% or 50%. This problem is not visible. If you have the problems with your teeth, it is hard. You go to the dentist, yeah. But you normally people maybe don't go to dentist because of prophylactic, just to control. Yeah, it's less. But with your head, it's no pain, so you don't go anyway. So yes, more or less, this is the issue. Yes, this is the other problem. This is the other problem. I think this, yes. So before, I think my advice is that before you think about outside world to have a career and etc., think about yourself, think about your needs. Before of thinking to fulfill the needs of other people, parents and teachers, etc., think about your needs. How to fulfill? What is your need? The people don't know what are their needs. They hear only about the needs from outside world. You should be like this. You should have these grades, etc., etc. So think about your needs. What you need in life? What is your mission? What is your purpose? Okay.
Thank you. Hi, Marek. Thank you for this thought-provoking session. I could have missed this part, but really interested to know. So, very simple questions. Why the Poles and why both? To give some context, so to reckon and to imagine, some people that go out for this kind of adventurous journey will be those who might be in the dilemma of ending their life, right? So that could be ours at any point, especially knowing that this expeditions to poles could put your life in any life-threatening situations. So why the poles and why both? Second, this is quite personal. So I lost my best friend 3 years ago. He committed suicide in front of, like right in front of me at the train stations. It's been 3 years, but I haven't managed. So for whatever reasons, I haven't managed. So do you have any advice? Thank you.
Yes, the first question, why two poles? I think there are different answers. They can be different answers for this question. Maybe 20 years ago, I would say yes, because they exist. Like there is a famous sentence of George Mallory, who tried to climb Mount Everest, and he was asked why Mount Everest, and he said because it is there. But recently I saw one Japanese movie, The Mountain of the Gods. The title was The Mountain of the Gods, and it was about, it's a fiction story, but the story was good. Like it was about the climber who wanted to climb Mount Everest. You know Mount Everest, the highest mountain in the world, in the hardest way, in the south face, like a steep wall. And he was asked why the Mount Everest, why in this way? And he said, because I am here. So why to pause? Because I am here, because I have free will. I have a choice. I can choose what I want to do in my life. And it is my choice. It is my personal choice. And why to pause? Yes, first because I have to do with my life what I want. And then because this pause, they were maybe inside me before even I heard about the North Pole and South Pole. So somehow these two poles, I think in the beginning was the North Pole only. So North Pole was like a mystical place. And terra incognita in Latin language, like the place who was undiscovered. So for me, this North Pole is like a human story to going in the uncertain future, to going with the no reference point. So. With all my background that I, because before the North Pole, I did many extreme trips. So for me, it was like a good metaphor of human existence. And as philosopher, I wanted to resolve this problem. If the human being can reach two poles in 1 year. So to make the story short. And the second question, I am not a therapist. I'm doing more with the prophylactic, but so it's really hard to advise. But for me, I also have many traumatic situations in my life. For me, I try to find the solution in the meaning of my life. Like I try to. Give the meaning to my life, and by giving the long time meaning, if you have like long term goals, like for example for me now, the long term goal is like to work with this method and to help many people in the world with prophylactics. So even if I have the daily failures, because I have these long term goals, it gives me power and meaning. So I could recommend you the book. There's a very small, very short book of the name of the writer is Viktor Frankl, and the name of the book is Man in Searching the Meaning, and it's about the stories about the author in the I think that maybe the hardest situation in the world. I don't want to go in the details, but this Viktor Frankl in this book he says that every person can survive even the hardest trauma or even the hardest situation if the person can find the meaning in the situation. So I would say if you find the meaning of this trauma, like in the situation that you was witness of, if you find the meaning in this, you can overcome this. But otherwise, I can also advise you to work with some like therapist. But they are different therapies, so it sometimes is very hard. You can have 100 therapies and they don't help. But yes, for me, like trying to find the meaning. But I recommend you this book because it's a very small book and it's very good good tool.
Thank you for your time, Mr. Kaminski. Well, actually, I would like to address the situation in this world, especially we are living in a period where everything is uncertain. And also so many things that happening around the world all these years, especially I would like to address to the young generations, especially Generation Y and Generation Z. who are somehow unprepared to face this new world, this new brave world that we are facing today, especially such as the inflations, wars, and some changes like revolution and anything else that perhaps could be happen at any time soon. What will you recommend to the young people, especially since they are not prepared in terms of mental health, especially, and awareness of the situation of the world, like the people, the children who are facing the same situation, like in Ukraine, in Palestine, in Myanmar, and many things else, especially in peaceful countries like in Japan, in Indonesia, who are somehow facing mass suicides recently. So do you think that this generation need to be teach more, or perhaps to be more well-armed in terms of mental health and spiritual, and of course in how to manage a good, healthy society? Because we know that in social medias and how people interact to each other right now is very, very different, unlike the old ways. And they somehow, I see that they're often to hate each other, they're often to avoiding each other if just because they are different to each other, or they are too shy to express their expression and opinions. I think you could perhaps give us some teachings and recommendation about this. Thank you.
Yes, you addressed many problems that at the moment there is not obvious solutions, but what I would recommend, or how it is from my point of view, and what is our approach to this problem in our foundation, and how is our approach to in creating the tools for this. So I would say that like before Z generation, or like before 2010, or before in the 20th century, you can prepare the way for yourself to the life. Yes, you can plan your life, that you have like school and study and job and family, and then you retire, you have some accounts in the bank and etc. So you can prepare the way for yourself. But now, because we are living in turbulent times, you cannot prepare the way. There is no way to prepare the way yourself, because there's so many problems that you mentioned, like pandemic, like wars, like crisis, mental health problems. There is no way to even with the money, you cannot buy the mental health. There is many rich people, they have millions of dollars, and they commit suicide, or also they have mental problems, or their children have mental problems, and they don't know how to deal with this. So I would say that you should not prepare the way for yourself, but you should prepare yourself to the way. So so this is, in short, the solution. Even this application, Life Plan App, this is about how to prepare to the way. So how to make the goals, how to be conscious, how to deal with the failures. So one, just to give you one example of the tool that you can use by every day. But of course, it's a bunch of solutions that you should try and to find the best for yourself. But one of the solutions that I try is like, there is like 5 minute meditation about three words, about mindfulness, about gratitude, about acceptance. I just think in the morning, I do some exercise like, for 20 minutes with the body, because body is also important. We are body and mind, so you should not forget your body. But these three words, like acceptance, you cannot control the world. So you is like, if you accept the reality, is you can move forward. if you don't accept and you are thinking, oh, it was white me, why this? Of course, acceptance, it doesn't mean that you agree with the bad things. It's just the acceptance of reality and going forward. So acceptance, gratitude, because there's many things that we can be no grateful, like we don't have this, the other people has this, we don't have this car or this, etc. But we have a lot of things that we can be grateful for, and one of the most important thing is life, because the life is given for us. We haven't paid for it, we don't earn it. You just have it for free, and we can live our life. We can wake up in the morning and we can deal with the problems. Many of my friends died in the expedition in Antarctica, and they cannot face the problems. So the life itself is, or the friends or the family, there's many things for sure. So I learned that gratitude allows you to grow, and if you are ungrateful, you just, it is depressing you. And then mindfulness, yes, because you are living only here and now. You are not living in the past, not in the future. So if you want to find some solutions, some things for the future, you have to be present. If I would be present, I would not meet my teachers who teach me about how to reach the pose. I wouldn't do nothing with it. The only reason that I get to the North Pole and South Pole, it was because I was present in the situation when I meet the people who helped me. Yes, because you never, in the life, you are never alone. I mean, if you do something, you are not a lonely island. It's always to have a success or to deal with things. You have to be connected with the world. Maybe with human beings, with the God, with spirituality, with the sun, with the nature, whatever. But you need connections. The real loneliness is not about to be alone in Antarctica, because you can be alone in Antarctica and still be connected with people, with nature, with yourself. And the real loneliness is disconnection from yourself and disconnection from the world. So try to be connected, but not by the social media, but with the real world, and first start from yourself. To be connected with the world, you need to be connected to yourself. Because somehow, as I said in the beginning, the outside world is a reflection of your inner world. It's a mirror of your mind. It's not true that we are in the same situation, in the same world now. We are in the same space, but our worlds are different because your worlds are in your minds. For some of you, the things that I say, maybe you can think, oh, maybe it's important. Maybe part of you is thinking what will be in 1 hour and when this event ends. Part of you maybe thinks about some events from the past. So we are the same space, but in different world. So try to be connected to your world, because the outside world is just your reflection. So if your inner world is unbalanced, the outside world will be unbalanced too. So this is like a couple of hints about this. And of course, try this, even the app. You have this in English, and you can go through, and it's quite easy. And I think you find some tools there to about these issues. Thank you very much. How is dziękuję in Indonesian? How is dziękuję? How is thank you in the Indonesian? Terima kasih. Terima kasih. Actually, I know 8 languages, but not Indonesian. Okay. Yes.
Okay. As a high schooler, we are surrounded by an environment like the where we this is the first step. We go in a new environment, right? So and there's probably new people and we meet new people, right? And then so what is your advice for the youth to stay resilient from negative influences from the new environment?
I think my advice is I think it's hard, but you should start from yourself. So when you think about self-esteem or self-value, or you should judge you should think about yourself, how you are judging yourself, not the other people, because the other people, they know only the part of you. Yes, so I have the same problems in the school, so I always try to have own opinions about myself and not to think too much of the other people's opinion. When I was in the school, some of my friends, they thought that I am crazy, why to go to the pole or why to do this kind of expedition. Because even in the high school, I was traveling in Africa, etc. So sometimes the people, they make jokes of me, and I was always like different from others. I always have problems. So you can, it's maybe not a good way, but you can also say to yourself, what doesn't kill you, kill me, it makes me stronger. So you can think about this opinions like the opportunity to improve yourself. Yes, like by dealing with this, you can improve yourself. So try to connect, to be connected to yourself, and try to rely on your opinions, not on the outside world opinions. Because you know yourself better than the other people, so why do you should rely on them? Yes, please.
Hi, Mr. Marek. My name is Clara, and I love to travel a lot.
Yes.
And previously, I went to Europe, and we were four of us going to seven countries, and we experienced a lot of unique things and also sad things. Like, for example, I lost my phone in Madrid at that time. But I learned a lot about travel, and still I do love travel. And here my question is, earlier you mentioned that North Pole and South Pole, there is no any reference to travel or having trip to those places. And what is your strategy before having the expedition? And also, do you have any tips for us, for me especially, who would like to have extreme trip? Thank you.
Yes, I said there is. If you are on in North Pole and South Pole, it's white and there is no reference points. But of course, how to prepare to the extreme expedition? I have the book in English, so maybe Cezary can send the copy by PDF of the copy in English, and you can. You can eventually read it, but I would say that this pole method, in fact, is about the preparation for extreme trips. So first of all, you need to define the goal, and then to make reference, to make a plan. I study all the expeditions in these places or similar places, and I try to learn from mistakes of the other expedition, what kind of the problems they have, what kind of equipment. So I think the main point of success in extreme expedition is preparation and patience. And so the expeditions, they are not about money, it's not about the equipment, it's about the know-how and preparation. To give you some advice, first of all, maybe if you want to start a like very extreme expedition, you should start from medium, like maybe Kilimanjaro, for example. I don't know, Kilimanjaro or whatever, in Carstens Pyramid, I think. I don't know if it's accessible, but the Carstens Pyramid is a good exercise camp in Indonesia. You know, Carstens Pyramid, Irian Jaya. Yeah, so I think you should start from Irian Jaya, and this is not very hard as I know, but you need of course preparation, and it's a good starting point. Irian Jaya or I don't know Kimabali. There is a couple of mountains in mountains are a good practicing camp for, and then. I don't know, there is Indonesian who went to the North Pole, South Pole. There is Indonesian people who reached the South Pole or North Pole. Have you heard about this? So maybe you should start to think about how to become first Indonesian woman to the South Pole. And the South Pole is, I think South Pole is accessible. It's you need preparation, you need yes, but the dreams don't become reality. You should help them with to make them your priority, to give them your heart and soul and energy. So if you have a dream and if you give the power to the dream by time, by priority, by your heart and your soul, then why not? I think yes, mountain and then South Pole. And by Cesare, I can send. There is my book, My Poles, I think, in English, and there is some at the end as appendix with advices how to prepare mentally, how to prepare physically, how to think about equipment, etc. Thank you.
Because of this dream and vision, yeah. So the first time when I got a scholarship, 2004, I was actually quite poor. Yeah, our family was quite poor, and there was no way I could fly and get a flight ticket to Indonesia. Even though I got a scholarship to be here, okay, how can I fly? So I hitchhiked to Iran, which took me 10 days, and then I took another bus, and then I got a ticket for $100, which I could afford. I ended up with no money in Indonesia. And within 2 months, I managed to get amoeba. I got an accident on a motorbike, and I was robbed with everything I had, you know? So some people in this situation say, oh my God, this Indonesia is a horrible place, and I don't want to be here anymore. But I thought, no, this is actually fantastic. I applied for a job as an English teacher. I went to B Radio in Bandung, and I started working. And actually, I made more money than I came with, yeah? So again, this is if you try, you can. And many years fast forward, I was working in a bank and I have this vision, I want to travel around the world. And I said to my wife, let's travel around the world. A lot of people say that, yeah, let's travel around the world. Okay, let's do it. It took us 7 years to prepare this trip. So, you know, we made a vision, we saved money, and we built it up for 7 years, how this happened. And this happened, right? And we did travel for 2 years around the world. So with the vision and long-term planning, dream, you can achieve great things, yeah?
But if you have any question to me, I am on the LinkedIn. I don't know if you are connected to LinkedIn or Facebook, Marek Kaminski Explorer, so you can ask me the question there, and I can send you also the copy of this book by LinkedIn. The best way to reach me is the LinkedIn.
Yeah, this is this. Exactly.
first trip of Mr. Marek Kaminski to Indonesia, but I think it's just the beginning, yeah? With the app, with all this that Indonesia needs, actually, you know, that they have, what you are doing.
Yes.
Work, I think that there's so much in terms of cooperation and helping, you know, each other, but I trust this is just the beginning.
Yeah, hopefully we can.
It's just the beginning, yeah?
Yes, hopefully we can. Maybe one. I publish 15 books in Poland, so maybe one of my book. I don't know if in. I hope that Indonesian people they are reading a book a lot, and maybe one of my books will be published in Indonesian. Some of my books were published in Japan and Korea and other countries, so maybe also in Indonesia. So yeah, maybe one day I come to the signing trip. Yeah, but yeah, as I said, you can reach me by LinkedIn, and sooner or later our programs will be also disponible in the Indonesian language, especially diagnostic. At the end of November, we plan to have a diagnostic in 26 languages, so maybe Indonesian is a fourth population in the world, so obviously it should be in the Indonesian. But it was really nice to meet you and have all these questions. You should remember, if you can remember one thing from my lecture or meeting, it is like the limits of your language are the limits of your existence, so try to think about language and about the meaning of the words that you give to them, and try to find the meaning of life in yourself first, before you find it in the outside world, and remember that to know the outside world you have to be to know yourself, and in order to know the outside world, you know to yourself, and in order to love the people, love like to be in love with the people, you have first to love yourself, yes, before you start to love other people, because if you are not in love with yourself, it is hard to be in love with other people. It is not about being egoistic, about thinking about yourself. It is about the real meaning of the words. So before you will be the leaders for the others, try to be the leader for yourself. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Please give a big hand once again. Yes, before we end our session today, I would like to invite Cesari and all those who already asked questions to take some pictures in front. Yeah, let's do the first one with the five questions. Yeah, the audience. Thank you. With that, we've come to the end of today's session. Thank you everybody for coming, and also for those tuning in on our YouTube channel. Thank you and see you in our next event.